Good evening. I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's work session for the Portsmouth Planning Board. The only item on the work session tonight is what we talked about last month, which is vesting of subdivision plans. And for that, I think we all agreed that we'd like Attorney Sullivan to come in and give us his position and answer some questions that we had on the vesting of subdivisions. I believe he's... So with that, I'll turn it over to Attorney Sullivan. Thank you for coming.
They pay me to do this.
But you do it for the love, either way.
I understood that the purpose of the work session was to basically continue the discussion and the questions and answers that were going on with respect to that Crockett lot in Tucker's Cove, which was, I suppose, a month ago now. In order to allow the planning board members to have something in front of them to which they might refer for discussion purposes, I've restated in a one-page memo a couple of the bases for which we found that the lots in that subdivision were vested to basically be developed under the zoning laws that existed at the time, at time of approval. And so I got those in front of you. There was a third basis that applies only to Tucker's Cove, and that's a result of a settlement of the case back at the time the project was approved by the planning board. And that basis is, number one, just unique to Tucker's Cove, wouldn't apply to anything else. It's a settlement of a case involving one subdivision. Second, it's not susceptible to a really quick interpretation. Nothing I could write on sort of a brief memo for you tonight. To the extent the board members wanted, we could make all the Tucker's Cove documents available. They're significant. My thought, frankly, was unless you had a question directly in front of you, you wouldn't want that much paper, and we'd save the trees. In thinking about this topic, vesting of the subdivision lots, subdivision project, since last month, some thoughts have occurred to me, one of which is, what is the manner in which these kind of vesting questions will arise from time to time in the planning department is such that, frankly, they should never get to the planning board. The vesting decision is going to get made prior to a time when anything comes to you. The reason why that Crockett question reached the planning board was that the planning department looked at a building permit application for a lot. They applied the then current, meaning this year's, zoning ordinance to that lot and determined conditional use permit and some other things necessary, and this has to come to the planning board, therefore, under current ordinances. So now it's headed to you. If the planning staff had made a vesting decision at the time they saw the building permit application, then those things simply wouldn't have come here and you never would have seen them. But what happened in that particular case was it was only after the questions were coming to you that Peter Laughlin got involved in it on behalf of the property owners. He raised the vesting issue at a kind of a later stage than it might have been brought up otherwise, or that the planning department might have raised it itself. And that's really the only reason that got to the planning board. Other than that, it wouldn't have become your problem as it did. Number one, these questions will not ordinarily be questions for you. But I understand that, and I totally agree, that members of the planning board were a little concerned with the sound of how some of this vesting law could work in connection with subdivisions in the city. And I absolutely agree with those members of the planning board who felt that this was a serious issue. I feel it's a serious issue. Those members of the planning board that suggested that perhaps this law, which we were talking about, might not be the best law for municipal regulation, I absolutely agree with them. But it is what it is, it says what it says, and we have to follow what exists. And basically, the two things I think that will come in front of you most are what I provided with, or they'll come before the city most, I provided to you tonight. So because of the questions, as I say, in the ordinary course of events would not be your issues to deal with. They're staff level issues to deal with. And if the staff makes a decision that a lot is vested or a lot is not vested, and the property owner disagrees or a neighbor disagrees or anybody disagrees with the staff level decision that's made at the time the building permit application is filed, the appeal from that staff decision is not to the planning board, it's to the zoning board. Appeal of administrative decision, which we get those periodically, and the zoning board makes the decision on them. And so even in the appeal process, it doesn't come to you. So that was like sort of my major thought during the last month or so since this happened is, you know, the planning board probably doesn't have to get too concerned about these things because they're not questions which will affect decisions you make directly. They affect staff level decisions, and it could certainly be Board of Adjustment appeals and, you know, judicial appeals. But you shouldn't see too many of these. And the only reason that Crockett thing came to you was because of the unusual sequence that I outlined. So with that, what we were doing the last time was we were having kind of a discussion and questions and answers and trying to deal with some concerns that board members had. And it seems to me, Mr. Chairman, unless you feel differently, that probably what we should do is just pick up right where we left off.
I agree. And then questions will go. Councilor Thorson?
Yes. Well, the first thought that comes to mind is in these circumstances where it turns out that a vesting question has come to the planning board, then it sounds like it should be remanded back to the planning department according to your process so that they can make a determination first and that we wouldn't do it at all, which is a little different than what we were talking about before when we were talking about vesting with relationship to this whole issue of completeness, and that we would make a determination of completeness prior to a vesting decision by the planning department. Now, how does all that fit in with what you just said?
The vesting that we discussed in that Crockett situation and the vesting discussed in this memo tonight is when vesting arises in the subdivision context. When does someone get to complete a subdivision project and build houses on lots after the zoning ordinance changes in a way that might not have allowed those houses, that kind of thing? There is another aspect to the vesting question, different than this one, and this is what you've seen on the city council, for example, which is when someone is trying to get a project commenced, to what degree is their plan subject to changes in zoning ordinance? It might help here to just quickly remind everybody, maybe people at home, what vesting is. Vesting is protection against subsequent changes in the land use regulations, so that a developer acquires at a moment that a project is vested. And in the context of when, before the project has begun or before the project has been approved, in general, the developer has to have a building permit in hand before the city council passes first reading and posts notice of second reading and a public hearing of an ordinance. It's a race to that point in time. And if the developer gets the building permit in hand before the council posts that notice, then that developer is vested against whatever change that council might be considering at that time. There is another similar process, which is must be a year ago now, a little more than a year ago now, the planning board, by its own regulations, adopted a design review process that had not previously been followed in the city. And one effect of having that design review process is that once the planning board has held a public hearing on a plan, then what's on that plan, what's shown on that plan, is now vested. And this is just by operation of statute during the approval process going forward. So there's, as a member of the council, you've seen that other one, and we've discussed it at some length. It's really a different vesting question.
Well, that's what I was trying to get to. It sounds like two different vestings, and I wanted to be clear about that, because really the vesting in this case, in terms of the subdivision, is really relying on a prior approval already, which means that we're not, in the first instance, we're not bringing an approval to a plan. And the issue of completeness is really along the lines of when we're giving a first approval to a plan, and that's really the distinction that you're making.
I agree. The second kind of vesting I just discussed is actually the first in time. That's vesting during the approval process. What we're talking about here in these examples and what we discussed in the Tucker's Cove case was the extent to which a project is vested after it's gotten its approvals and even construction has begun.
Thank you.
I guess my biggest concern is not so much what's going to happen with this particular case, but it's going to be what happens with other subdivisions going down the road. Because we have a lot of cases, and we've done a lot of changing to our zoning to protect the wetlands, and now we have a lot of people coming before us who want to build in buffers and whatnot. So where, I guess, is there a true definition of when the subdivision is substantially complete? Like, do all the streets have to be done that were in the plan? Is there something that would tell us that? Because I don't want, I mean, we have both the common law, the statute, and the agreement that allows us to move this one forward. But going down the road, I think it's important to make sure we kind of also spell out the details of what makes this meet those so that we don't have these issues.
Sure. We'd be discussing now about what on that memo was shown as the statutory vesting. Mm-hmm. And the statute provides this a definition of substantial completion. This is at RSA 674:39, Roman 1, subsection C. it's in here. All right. That's actually subsection, it's Roman 3A, and it reads, substantial completion of the improvements as shown on the subdivision plan or site plan for purposes of fulfilling this provision, and active and substantial development of building for purposes of fulfilling this provision are, let's see. It's defined somewhere in it. Peter, you know where in the statute that definition occurs?
Substantial completion.
Yeah.
For a subdivision.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that it's because we, excuse me, for our site plan review regulations, we had to define it. We amended our site plan review regulations to define even substantial and
it's used all over here, but
it seemed to me that there's a default definition that says if the board does not define it, if the city does not define it, then it's anything practically.
Do we talk about vesting in the site plan regulations?
We do. It's a different thing than what we're talking about here with subdivision. But we actually amended the regulations last year.
You know, there's got to be a definition to this.
Well, that's my concern. If there isn't an appropriate one, then maybe we need to somehow work that into our zoning to make sure that that can't be used against us at a later date.
It would be in our subdivision regulations.
Well, you know, I mean, what the statute actually says is active and substantial development or building is begun on the site by the owner or the owner's successor in interest. So I guess absent some more.
Right, because I know, like, when you're just talking about one lot, one house, there's an easy way to determine that. But we're talking about a whole subdivision with planned roads and planned improvements. So, you know, all the utilities have to be in? Do all the roads have to be done? Like, what makes a true full subdivision substantially complete?
Good, you know,
I've never found it. I looked and I didn't find it. So
I'm not seeing it right now either. But it's got to be.
Maybe it's open to
be defined by cases, if nothing else.
I hadn't spent that much time on it, but I just think that would be something we should make sure of.
Let's not leave yet.
It's not that much time. I'm sure it is somewhere, but if it's not, then we need.
Yeah, it's not showing up here.
You could see where there could be a hole if somebody says, well,
yeah,
well, you know, we meet two out of three, so that should be okay.
Regulations?
Yeah.
I thought you had it was memorized.
It's not. But there are, like, new subdivisions that were never finished. Roads weren't finished, and they're on wetlands, and now people are coming before the boards to build on them, and I don't want
all over the place and not defined.
The words have been
yeah. 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 Active.
It's my one red flag. There is, I'm sure. I couldn't find it.
Yeah, we're not finding it.
And it's fine if we don't. I just think it like I said, it doesn't apply really to now.
It is used all over the place here and not defined here.
So my concern is that down the road we should possibly take a look at defining that, or
not in the subdivision regs.
Okay, that's a good point. That's a great point.
Because it is, as I've watched. I mean, I watch a lot of these boards besides our own, and there are some people that are going to be coming before us with half-completed subdivisions, in my personal opinion. And if it's not defined, then I don't want them being able to try to say, "Oh, we meet the common law, we meet the statute, so we should be able to, you know find a different."
You know, we can find something. I can't find it right here, right now, like this.
And the question begs: How do you come up with that definition?
Right. Well, that's why it would take some thought. Probably take a smarter person than me.
I was just pointing out to Jay the definition of site plan regs, and we actually took a fairly strict position in the site plan regs. We said substantial completion is defined as the establishment of all on-site and off-site improvements specified in the site plan approval, except for those improvements which are specifically deferred by recorded vote of the planning board prior to the expiration of the four-year period. So basically it says substantial completion is completion unless the board votes to let something else slide.
It has to be done within 4 years.
Yeah.
That's pretty strict.
Oh, Tucker's Cove is done.
Thank you.
Long done.
Right, like I said, I don't think it would apply to this one. I'm just thinking of other things that we're going to see.
That's a great point.
Well, I'm not finding it. But it's got to be someplace.
So, question I have is in the memo here, the statute, Roman numeral 1, talking about exceptions and how it's exempt from all changes in regulations. I'm just paraphrasing.
Yeah.
Except those regulations and ordinance which expressly protect public health standards such as water quality and sewage treatment requirements. Wouldn't a wetlands ordinance be included in that water quality, or is it public drinking water, or is it, you know, I mean, 21st century now, we know that you affect water, it affects everything. So our changes in our zoning, so is it still vested under wetland zoning ordinances, or if we change that?
Well, I remember in the case of the Crockett lot, there were actually three independent bases for vesting.
Yeah.
And I do think that, let me start a little earlier than that. I'm personally sort of offended by the policy of laws that suggest that once a subdivision lot has been approved, then the city can never do anything else ever again to regulate development on that lot. I'm personally offended by that policy and have always approached the vesting questions with that thought in mind. It's created a lot of arguments between myself and lawyers representing developers, Peter in particular, numerous occasions. I do think that environmental type regulations are the best argument to, as being the kind of changes against which a lot does not become vested forever. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm sorry to bring up the Crockett one again, but it's just
fine.
Because it's the one that brought it to our attention, is talking about vesting, and you mentioned a lot more paperwork with the agreement and stuff, and this is just one knowledge too, is that from Peter Laughlin's extensive memo, he excerpted that, and they put into a contract that they were exempt from section like 10.606, and they used the title of the wetlands. Now, they said they were exempt from those. Well, that section, literally that section number is no longer in our zoning ordinance. That title, that zoning is not in our ordinance anymore. So they, it seems to me that that law that they wanted protection from no longer exists. So,
right. But the argument was that if back at the time of the approval of that subdivision, they were protected against the wetland ordinance buffer as it existed back then,
okay,
and it was shorter, smaller than it is now, then obviously they were intended to be protected against a larger one, because, you know, the protection that they got would, by the agreement, would be totally lost. As you know, all right, well, you can't, you're protected, you can build up to 20 feet, within 20 feet of the wetlands, but if we make that buffer 50 feet, you're not protected at all. You know, it's just not a logical interpretation of the agreement.
Question for you, no particular application that we may be seeing, but standalone lots that have been taxed as a buildable lot for several years, is the difference being that there was no action taken on them, that they've stood by themselves, or how do we differentiate a standalone lot from a subdivision insofar as I've owned this, I've been taxed for 60 years on it, at that point there was no wetland buffer?
These cases only talk about lots and subdivisions, and a standalone lot that's been there since the year 1758 isn't entitled to this kind of vesting protection.
Because it hasn't been tried, or because it's been tried and decided that?
Well, you don't have the situation where an owner relying in good faith on the absence of any regulation has commenced the project. So you don't get this.
Right.
And the common law provision. And you wouldn't get the statutory one because there wouldn't be a plat approved by the planning board.
You see where that could at some point grow legs? And I mean, it has all the same ingredients, if you will, of other than a development or a subdivision, but.
Well, the vesting question can be raised from two different sides. The city could itself make a determination at the time the building permit application is filed that we think there's some vesting here, and we have to review this under an earlier version of the zoning ordinance. And we could raise the issue ourselves. Mm-hmm. And even that, of course, can create a sort of aggrieved parties. A next-door neighbor might not agree with the city's interpretation, right, and say, well, you shouldn't be vesting that lot. So it can come up from us, or it can come up from the property owner or developer who wishes to build something. They can say, well, wait a minute, you can't apply the current zoning ordinance to us. We're vested. If we raise it ourselves, obviously we think that it's a proper vesting situation. And if it's raised by someone else, then we just review it and determine whether we agree or not. And these cases talk about a lot of different things you would look at, one of which you've mentioned, which is if a lot is taxed as a buildable lot for a period of years, then that is something that the municipality and the courts would look at to determine if that lot was vested as a buildable lot.
For example. Okay.
Very specifically discussed in some of the cases.
Okay.
One question I think we asked is, how many of these lots from subdivisions still exist? Was that able to be looked into? I mean, is there still elsewhere in the city?
This is one of the other kind of nightmares that we deal with kind of regularly now. Because until the middle part of the last century, anybody could record a subdivision plan for anything with no approval by anybody. Over in the registry right now, there's all kinds of plans recorded showing 25-foot wide lots, and I think what one of, maybe it was Peter's book, trolley car subdivisions, he said, and because of, you know, the relatively recent state law regarding unmerger of involuntarily merged lots, we now are seeing these kind of regular, and so the situation, the law now is, some lots that were created at a time when there was no regulation, there was no planning board, there was no review, and there was no approval but the lots were created 150 years ago, 25 feet wide. And so 50 years ago, the city, as a matter of zoning or tax assessment, those are the two ways it happens, says, well, these three 25-foot wide lots in common ownership aren't usable for any purpose as 25-foot lots. So the city did, all municipalities, I think, did this, consolidated those lots into one 75-foot wide lot. Because of this current state law, the owner of that property can come in, and unless they've done something that voluntarily merged lots, like built a house on all three of them, they have an absolute right to compel the city, by a request of the city council, to unmerge those lots and recreate the 25-foot wide ones. We've done it half a dozen times now.
Bob, those lots aren't vested because they were never approved by the planning board, so they still have to go to the Board of Adjustment to get variances.
I'm not suggesting they're vested, but the lots will now exist.
Bob, I have a couple questions. We've talked about this a little bit. In terms of this, the idea of a subdivision that's vested, I guess the question is what actually is vested. And one of the places I think about is Elwin Park. Elwin Park, it was approved as a subdivision at a time when the minimum lot size was something like 6,000 square feet or something like that. And over time, the zoning has been changed to make it 15,000 mm-hmm. square foot minimum lot size. And when we see a lot line revision between two lots, my presumption would be that if the lot goes below 15,000 square feet or if the frontage goes below 100, it requires a variance. But is that not true? Should it really be judged under the zoning that was in effect in 1950, whatever?
What I think it's vested is the project that got approved. So Tucker's Cove project got approved, showed single-family homes on all these lots. So what I think is vested is the right of that developer to put a single-family home on all those
on
lots.
That lot, okay.
So that's what I think.
And then the other.
And I'm willing to fight pretty long about that.
And then the other question is, and I think this is the question, maybe it's the question you were asking, was in terms of how many lots there are that are still out there. Is there a line in the mid-1990s where all subdivisions approved before that are not subject to wetland regulations, and all subdivisions approved after that are subject to wetland regulations? And that's kind of the extreme point of view, is that if the subdivision itself was approved and built at a time when there were no wetland regulations, and the subdivision doesn't show houses on it, so you don't know where they intended to build a house. Could a house then be built in a wetland?
I think that there's no good answer to that question, and I think that there are lots out there that fit that scenario exactly, and that someday we're going to have to fight one out to the death, but it hasn't happened yet.
I remember bringing up if by chance an Atlantic Heights lot has never been developed. Well before zoning came to the city, we could have our first 100, 200-foot skyscraper. You know, I know it's an extreme, but I just wonder if that was a possibility.
There is so much wetlands in the city, and there's more wetlands now than there ever was in the past, and there's more wetlands regulations now than there ever was in the past. And I am sure there are lots out there somewhere that were probably buildable at the time the lots were created that we would not consider buildable under any stretch of our rules and regulations now. And I suppose somebody come forward and say, well, I'm vested, you can't apply your wetlands regulations, I'll put my house on stilts out there or something. And we would probably actually adopt the argument that you made a little earlier tonight and say, well, no, this wetlands regulation is a type that you do not get vested against. And off we would go.
And Councilor Thorson?
Well, okay, I'm a little bit confused then, because I thought that a lot would not become vested, and you couldn't put a 100-story building, and you couldn't build a house on stilts, unless it were already approved plan to do something like that prior to the ordinance change. If there was no approved plan prior to that, then the lot, undeveloped with no substantial investment into any construction on the land, and without a plan in place, they would not be able to rely on the older ordinances.
Right. The situation I was trying to address is actually the case where there is a plan.
Where they started building a house on stilts.
No, plan creating the lot.
Well, they could have created the lot, but the lot goes according to a plan. And in the plan, you have some designation as to what's going to be built. Right. You can't then change the plan. I thought we discussed this actually the last time, but if there was a 100-story building as part of the original plan, I could see that they could probably make a good argument for it. But they would have to have something like that in place to be able to do that, right?
I was trying to get at that angle when I said what gets vested is the project.
Right, exactly.
Not some other project.
But the issue, I think, with the subdivision is that oftentimes there's no building shown in a subdivision plan.
Right.
So another example in Elwin Park is that the height limit was very different back then than it is today. And you could build a taller building back then than you can today. So I think that's a good point. It may not be a 100-foot building, but it could be a 45-foot building where everything else in the subdivision is 35 feet maximum. So I mean that's kind of we do have these kind of strange things out there that people could be doing. And this is something we may look at in the planning department, and without thinking about it, we may see a plan come in and says, well, you're showing a 40-foot high building, and the single residence district only has 35 feet, so we're not going to allow you to do it.
And that is what we would say, somebody might raise a vesting issue. No, I have a right to build a 100-foot tall building out there, and the battle's joined.
Ultimately, a court would be deciding that.
Or they might come to us, and they may, before the court, they may come to us and point it out, and we internally may say, you're right, you can't.
And that's what happened in the Crockett situation. We read all of Peter Lachlan's materials and met with him, and found him to be persuasive in the end, and we adopted his view as being the correct one on that lot that day.
And I think there's so many, that's why people in your profession or in business that, I'm serious. Subdivisions typically don't show anything. They show meets and bounds.
Right. If a subdivision plan approved by the planning board happened to show the location of proposed houses, well, then that's a much better argument that developer is entitled to build a house in that location because the planning board actually saw it and it was part of the plan they approved. If no locations, then less of an argument that,
Interesting.
William? Future, actually, now that we've talked about past, future subdivisions, is there anything that we could do for stipulations so that if they show a plan, they have it laid out, but for some reason, 20 years down the road, they want to develop the rest of that. Maybe it was a subdivision of 10, they did 5, and 20 years later, they do want to do 5 more, but our laws have changed. Is there any stipulations we could do now so that way they could go with the ordinances 20 years in the future?
I do not believe that you could directly contravene the statute by a stipulation. Okay. However, in a particular case, if there was some particular concern, let's say one lot had a particular configuration adjacent to a wetlands or something, mm-hmm. I think you could make specific stipulations that dealt with specific situations. You just couldn't abrogate the whole vesting by means of a stipulation.
Okay.
I think you could do that.
Interesting.
Don't we now, on our subdivisions, for example, the one we just did out with Lang Road, we typically have them put a typical building footprint in on their plans?
Microphone.
Don't we typically require that on the subdivision? Because I think we had it on the Sanderson Field and also on Langwood. I thought we had them put, because we have them, whether it's because of septic, to make sure that they can put a building, applicable building footprint and a septic system in that case, or even we were struggling with some of the building locations on the Sanderson. So I thought I don't know if it's a written requirement or we're just asking them to do that, or they're doing it by practice.
I think it's more by practice, but that's a good point. If again, as Bob says, if something is shown on the plan, that's what the planning board approves. Then you can assume that you're not going to be if you're only showing 10% coverage of the lot, you can assume that you're not going to be going to 50% coverage of the lot.
Right, they, when I've had these problems in the past.
The point at which I get most upset, really, is with the concept that somehow someone gets vested to complete something because a plan got approved, even though that something wasn't shown on the plan. Which, you know, that's my hard spot right there. You know, I could kind of get it that if the planning board approves a plan for somebody and the plan shows things, then it's kind of not fair for the city to change the rules afterwards and prohibit that person from building those things. But, you know, a liberal reading of all this stuff does lead you to the conclusion that things that were never shown to the planning board are nonetheless vested because they would have been allowed under the zoning ordinance at the time the planning board approved the plan, even though the planning board never saw those things. That's my, I have a lot of trouble with that concept, and that's where the most of the problems have happened between me and others in the past.
Interesting. Yes, sir.
Here's another one that I think is actually could have a lot of implications in the Central Business District, which is that a subdivision plan includes a lot line revision plan. So that a lot line revision plan, which is approved by the planning board and recorded at the registry, would then be vested as to the zoning in effect at the time the plan was approved. Now, what about our recent rezoning of the entire Central Business District to character-based zoning? Are the many lots in the downtown that have had some type of lot line revision, are they still vested under the old Central Business zoning?
Well, I'm saying that parties are only vested to projects that got approved.
Okay.
So if the lot line relocation plan showed something being built as a result of this lot line relocation, right, maybe then,
okay,
but not otherwise.
Okay.
Keeps it simple.
Yeah. Safe.
Any other questions for Attorney Sullivan? No? Really appreciate you coming in. Anytime we have these work sessions, it's always informative, and hopefully this gives us more direction that seems like more on a plan is better than less.
I think anybody would agree that we're all better off, the city's better off, and frankly, even the developers who come before you are better off if we talk about stuff before it becomes a problem and try to come to understanding how to deal with things before we have a problem rather than waiting until we got a problem. So I encourage this kind of stuff whenever you think it's a good idea.
No, I really appreciate it. So that being said, do we want to call for an adjournment until 7 o'clock?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you.